My husband is amazing and he's an athlete, so it's very important that we eat healthy and clean in our household. He actually makes us juices. So that is the first thing that I do every morning is drink the juice, the fresh juice that he makes. So it's got like beets and celery and cucumber, lemon, ginger. So I definitely, I have like a 12 ounce every morning. That's like my go-to. Feels, you know, energized and refreshed. And then come home usually and have a protein shake after my workout. And then what else do I eat? I love avocado so much. So like if I'm feeling like, ooh, I just, especially with endometriosis, like that's a very good healthy fat. So sometimes I'll just scoop it right out of the shell and eat it, which my husband hates. So I'm like, give me all the avocados. I'll take all of yours. Thank you. He is the champion of championing our like healthy living. He wakes up early, he goes to bed early. So, you know, if I want to hang out with him, I got to wake up early and go to bed early. So, but that is really important. Sleep is huge. I think that like my lifestyle, I used to go to sleep really late because I used to do shows and stuff like that. So my mornings would be a little bit later. But I have to say, like when I can go to bed at like 10 o'clock and wake up at 6 or 7, I mean, it is the greatest thing in the world. You feel like you have 10 more hours in a day. It's awesome. I wake up and I like do priming every morning. So like I, you know, breathe in and out of my nose really fast, like 30 times, 3 times. And I think of things that I'm grateful for, things that I also want to achieve that day. And by achieve, I mean, like put a smile on somebody's face, like really small, you know, things that are attainable. Because I think when sometimes we put goals that are so big out there and they feel so far away, it can be discouraging. So, you know, I always try to create really attainable goals so that, you know, I feel really good about myself that day and that I can achieve it. And so, things that I'm grateful for, I love to meditate and sort of like get in a great place for the day. That's all kind of in one little thing. What else do I do? Sometimes, I don't know, making a nice cup of tea in the morning is like my little ritual that I love, and I get to, you know, take the girls outside, my girls, my dogs, and just, you know, spend the morning with them, having some like peace and like present time. I think sometimes in the past I would wake up and rush right out the door, and it was great for what it was, but sometimes I felt like I was always thinking like, what's next, what's next, what's next, versus like just sitting and in like noticing my surroundings. So I think the best thing for me is that I mix it up a bunch. So even if it is one workout style, I make sure that whatever style that is, I'm constantly mixing it up, because if my body gets used to something, like just one little change and it shocks my body again, that's when I really see results. So if it's doing something like Training Mate, which has been really fun, like a circuit training, high intervals, then like that's great because I constantly feel like my body's being shocked. I love to dance. Dancing, you use every muscle in your body, even muscles you didn't even know you had, because they're so deep, you know, and like the way that you move your body is what like makes a dancer's body. So that's why I love the cardio aspect. You're having fun and there's like a release. So it's almost like an emotional freedom as well when you dance, that I think a lot of people strive to get when they work out. So I love to dance. It would be a really fun, I don't know, way to sweat, to get endorphins and to release whatever you need to release. Obviously, everybody's treatment is different. Everybody's case is different and individualized and unique. So with me specifically, you know, I've had, you know, medical treatment, I've had surgical treatment, I've had both. And who knows what amazing developments are gonna have or happen in the future. All I can say is that I just wanna be able to bring awareness to women to actually speak up. I think that's the first thing, is just to be able to speak up. At the end of the day, like if we're having a conversation about something that people find uncomfortable to talk about, like we need to change that. And so that's what speaking endo is about, speak endo. So I think that's just Yeah, that's the first thing that I would say is just like have a conversation and like educate yourself. And once you start doing that, I hope that there's a plethora of new, you know, developments with treatment. I think the greatest thing about this campaign, Speak Endo, is that we do have a hashtag, Speak Endo. And when you have a community that's really safe, where there's no judgment, and also just like you can ask questions with people who have endometriosis or that are curious, the first thing you can do is just, you know, ask, like, what are the symptoms? These are some symptoms that I'm having right now. I'm not sure what questions I need to ask when I go and see, you know, my healthcare, you know, physician. And so, you know, like, what can you help me out? I think a lot of the times, especially, I don't know, maybe my case, we as women maybe feel like we're in like survivor mode and we have to do everything ourselves. And that's served us great because we're strong and powerful women. But at the same time, it's okay to ask for help. And I think that, like, especially young women, like, you reach out to your peers, reach out to your friends and your family and people that you look up to, have mentors. You know, like, that's it's a really powerful thing to ask for help. I don't know, I always say, like, with vulnerability comes strength. And, like, I couldn't agree with that more, especially when it comes to endometriosis. Hi, I'm Julianne Huff, and you're watching LiveStrong.com.